TAG TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Lipakshi Khurana. Here are the top stories we're tracking for you on Monday, the 18th of November. Winter session of Indian Parliament begins. Bhutanese Foreign Minister meets Indian leadership in New Delhi. And Gotabaya Rajapaksa sworn in as Sri Lanka's new president. Now for all the details, the winter session of the Indian Parliament began on Monday. Many key bills, including the Citizenship Bill, are scheduled to be tabled this session, which will go on till December 13th. Calling the winter session an important one, Prime Minister Narendra Modi said all lawmakers should contribute to enrich the discussions.
The winter session of the Indian Parliament began on Monday and is likely to witness heated discussions on several issues, including economic slowdown. Nearly 27 bills are scheduled to be presented in the Parliament, including the Citizenship Amendment Bill 2019, which seeks to grant citizenship to non-Muslims from Bangladesh, Pakistan and Afghanistan. Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Monday expressed the hope that the winter session of the Parliament will be a productive one with high-quality debates in which all lawmakers will contribute through their intellect.
हम सभी मुद्दों पर खुलकर के चर्चा चाहते हैं। उत्तम से उत्तम बहस हो ये आवश्यक है। वाद हो, विवाद हो, संवाद हो, हर एक कोई अपनी बुद्धि शक्ति का प्रचुर मात्रा में उपयोग करे और सदन की चर्चा को समृद्ध बनाने में योगदान दे और उससे जो अमृत निकलता है वो देश के उज्जवल भविष्य के लिए काम आता है.
Prime Minister Modi later addressed the 258th session of the Rajya Sabha, the upper house of the parliament. Both the upper house and the lower house began by paying tributes to former federal ministers, including Arun Jaitley and Sushma Swaraj. A joint sitting of both houses of the parliament will be held on November 26 to mark the 78th anniversary of the adoption of the Constitution of India by the Constituent Assembly. With 20 sittings, the winter session of the parliament will end on December 13.
Justice Sharad Arvind Bobde took oath as the 47th Chief Justice of India on Monday. 63-year-old Bobde, who succeeded Justice Ranjan Gogoi, will have a tenure of over 17 months as the CJI and is due to retire on April
23, 2021. Justice Sharad Arvind Bobde took oath as the 47th Chief Justice of India on Monday. He was administered the oath of office by President Ramnath Kovind in a ceremony at Presidential Palace, Rashtrapati Bhavan, in capital New Delhi. 63-year-old Bobde, who succeeded Justice Ranjan Gogoi, will have a tenure of over 17 months as the CJI. Justice Bobde has been chosen following the rule of seniority and his name was recommended by Justice Gogoi in a letter to the centre. Hailing from a family of lawyers from Maharashtra, he is the son of eminent senior advocate Arvind Srinivas Bobde. Justice Bobde has decided several key cases and was part of a five-member Supreme Court bench that handled the Ayodhya land dispute case. In March 2019, a bench headed by Justice Bobde refused a blanket ban on firecrackers. Justice Bobde will retire as CJI on April 23rd, 2021.
Minister of Foreign Affairs of Bhutan, Thandi Dorji, met Indian Interior Minister Amit Shah in New Delhi on Monday to strengthen bilateral ties. India and Bhutan share a unique and time-tested bilateral relationship characterized by mutual trust, goodwill and understanding. Dorji was also scheduled to hold talks with his Indian counterpart, S. Jaishankar, late in the day and review the entire gamut of India-Bhutan relations. Earlier, he met Indian Foreign Secretary Vijay Gokhale after his arrival on Sunday. During his five-day trip, he will also visit Bodh Gaya, one of the most important Buddhist pilgrimage sites, and meet political leadership in eastern India. Moving on, Mutahida Qawmi Movement or MQM founder Altaf Hussain, living in exile in the UK, has urged Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi to grant him and his colleagues asylum in India or at least some financial assistance to take his case to the International Court of Justice.
Altaf Hussain, the founder of Mutahida Qawmi Movement or MQM, one of Pakistan's main political parties, has requested Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi to grant him and his colleagues asylum in India. 67-year-old Hussain, who lives in exile in the UK since 1992, has also sought financial assistance for himself and his companions from the Indian Prime Minister to take his case to the International Court of Justice. He said his house and offices have been seized in Pakistan, leaving him with no means to fight for justice. Hussain is also due to stand trial in the UK, charged with an offence of encouraging terrorism, with a speech relayed to his followers in Pakistan a few years ago.
I am a peaceful person, peace-loving. I will not interfere any politics, I promise. But just give me, along with my colleagues, a place to live in India.
Altaf Hussain's MQM has dominated Pakistan's largest city, Karachi, since the 1980s. When security forces cracked down on the party in the 1990s, he sought asylum in the United Kingdom. Even from exile in London, he has been a vocal critic of Pakistan's policies and often blames it of using force to muzzle dissenting voices in the country.
In news from Pakistan, Pakistan's Prime Minister Imran Khan has directed the government's legal team to review the Lahore High Court's decision to allow former Premier Nawaz Sharif to travel abroad for medical treatment. The court on Saturday suspended the government's condition of indemnity bonds for Nawaz Sharif's travel.
Pakistan's Prime Minister Imran Khan has directed the government's legal team to review the Saturday's decision of the Lahore High Court allowing former Premier Nawaz Sharif to travel abroad for medical treatment. In the decision that has dealt a major blow to the government, the court directed the authorities to remove the three-time Prime Minister's name from the no-fly list and suspended the government's condition of indemnity bonds for Nawaz Sharif's travel. The Pakistani government had granted Sharif a one-time permission to travel abroad for treatment for 4 weeks, provided he submits an indemnity bond to the tune of ₹7 to ₹7.5 billion. Sharif's party, Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz, said the ailing leader will travel to London on Tuesday via air ambulance for medical treatment. 69-year-old Sharif was released on bail last month from a 7-year sentence for corruption after repeated medical issues. He denies the corruption charges, claiming they are politically motivated.
Gotabaya Rajapaksa was on Monday sworn in as Sri Lanka's 7th president, a day after he was declared the winner in the closely fought election in the South Asian island nation. Gotabaya had campaigned on the plank of security and economic revival.
Gotabaya Rajapaksa, Sri Lanka's former civil wartime defence chief, was declared the winner in the presidential election on Sunday after promising to secure the country against militant threats following the deadly Easter Sunday bombings this year. Sri Lanka's Elections Commissioner Mahinda Deshapriya said Rajapaksa won 52.25% of the votes in the Saturday's election, while main rival and government housing minister Sajit Premadasa got 41.99%. 70-year-old Gotabaya of the Sri Lanka Podu Jana Perumuna Party had campaigned on the plank of security and economic revival. He had promised to fight corruption and make Sri Lanka safe. Gotabaya Rajapaksa is the younger brother of former President Mahinda Rajapaksa, and both brothers are popular with the Sinhalese majority and the powerful Buddhist clergy. Millions voted to elect a new president to lead the country out of its deepest economic slump in over 15 years.
A three-day chanting ceremony to promote Tripitaka, the traditional scriptures for the Buddhist among people, concluded in Lumbini, the birthplace of Lord Buddha in Nepal. The event witnessed participation of monks and nuns from 25 different countries.
Lumbini, the birthplace of Lord Buddha in Nepal's Rupandehi district, echoed with the verses of Tripitaka, the traditional scriptures for the Buddhist, as scores of pilgrims from different countries participated in a chanting ceremony for 3 days. The event to mark the second episode of Tripitaka chanting ceremony witnessed different chantings by the international participants, including monks, in their own languages and styles. The ceremony concluded with the lighting of candles in the holy garden of Maya Devi Temple.
International Tripitaka chanting is helping to promote Lumbini, the birthplace of Buddha, as a, you know, the spiritual destinations. It will help to enhance spirituality in the Buddha's birthplace, because very few people know that the exact authentic birthplace of the Buddha, Lumbini, Nepal.
The first episode of chanting ceremony was held in 2018, which was participated by about 700 monks and nuns from 18 countries. The Tripitaka, which holds high significance in Buddhism, is a lesser known fact to the people. The organizers hope that such events would help in making people aware of the scriptures.
Scores of devotees are visiting the Sabarimala temple in India's southern Kerala province as the holy shrine has opened for pilgrimage season. The worshippers on Monday were seen in full zeal to enter the hilltop shrine of Lord Ayyappa to offer prayers.
Hundreds of devotees on Monday queued up outside the Sabarimala temple in India's southern Kerala province as the holy shrine has opened for monthly prayers. The worshippers were seen in full zeal to enter the hilltop shrine of Lord Ayyappa and offer him prayers. The devotees who undergo the pilgrimage to the holy shrine during the worship month follow some strict rules, like they only have vegetarian diet, follow celibacy, allow the hair and nails to grow, and bath twice in a day. They even wear plain black or other traditional clothing.
We took about 1 hour time from to park the vehicle in Nilakal. From there, to find the bus, it was a mad rush. Then we made it, finally we made it, and we are in front of Lord Ayyappa.
We are feeling blessed. We have spent so much of time, and all this waiting is for this one moment. And it's really, mind-blowing. We feel privileged.
The Sabarimala Hill Shrine traditionally restricts women from age 10 to 50 years from entering the temple. However, India's Supreme Court permitted entry of women in its 2018 ruling, which got a mixed response. There were also cases of violence whenever women tried to go there. A petition by the National Ayyappa Devotees Association has been filed for rehearing the case in the Supreme Court, citing that the devotees of Lord Ayyappa were not heard previously.
Well, that's the way it was in South Asia this evening. Before we conclude, the top stories once again. Winter session of Indian Parliament begins. Bhutanese Foreign Minister meets Indian leadership in New Delhi. And Gotabaya Rajapaksa sworn in as Sri Lanka's new president. Now our viewers can watch the show on SouthAsiaNewsline.com. You can also visit us on Facebook.com/SAsianewsline and follow us on Twitter at SAsianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We'll see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Prayag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.